Data from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, analyzed by the nonprofit Climate Central, shows that since 1970, many U.S. cities have experienced increased hourly rainfall intensity, with much of the Great Lakes region being in the most affected areas. Stephen Shaw is a professor at the State University of New York's College of Environmental Science and Forestry, and he joins me now. Professor, what's driving this trend of increasing rainfall intensity?
So the primary cause is basically the ability of the atmosphere to hold more moisture. So we often talk about relative humidity. So if temperature goes up, we basically have an increased ability to hold moisture in the atmosphere. So on a day, maybe it's 30 or 40 degrees out, you basically have a sort of a limit to how much moisture you can have. And we don't really talk too much about how much humidity is there when it's 30 or 40 out. But when it's 70 or 80 or 90 degrees, we often think about the humidity. So the same thing's happening here as we experience climate change. As we have more days with higher temperature, we basically have more capacity to hold more moisture. If you have more moisture in the atmosphere on the day when there is rain, you can have more condensation and you have more rainfall.
So it seems like there's a direct link between an overall warming and the potential for heavy rain events. How much warming have we seen already?
Well, in terms of the last 50 years or so, we've seen around 1 degree C, so that's around 2 degrees Fahrenheit. So in terms of this increase in moisture holding capacity, it's around 7 to 8% per degree increase Celsius. So in this terms of this 1 degree Celsius increase, we have about already a 7 or 8% increase in moisture holding capacity and consequently an increase in precipitation intensity.
According to the data, on the heaviest 1% of days, rainfall in the upper Midwest and Northeast rose by 45 and 60% respectively between 1958 and 2021, so more than other parts of the country. This is U.S. data, but it seems likely that Southern Ontario has seen a similar increase. So with rain falling faster, what are the anticipated impacts on flood risks in the Great Lakes region? Are certain areas more vulnerable than others?
Well, the one thing with flood risk is it also depends on what we refer to as antecedent conditions. So basically, how wet is the soil before that rainfall occurs? So in some cases, if you have sort of natural systems, say a forested system, if you have drier soils or your soil wetness hasn't increased that much, just having increased rainfall intensity might not change flood risk that much. The place where you probably see the most impact is more urban areas. So you have what we refer to as impervious surface, so pavement and concrete, roofs, things like that. So basically you have a direct connection between rainfall intensity and the amount of runoff that you generate. So oftentimes, if you look at the record of sort of changes in basically magnitude of stream flows, you don't really see that strong a change or increase in the magnitude of stream or river flows in the Northeast and in the Midwest for the most part. But what we tend to see more often is basically increased flooding in urban areas. And that's a direct connection to increased rainfall intensity.
Right. So with many cities in the region having experienced this increased rainfall intensity, even as their sewer infrastructure ages, how equipped are these systems to handle an increase in heavy rainfall events?
Well, I think there's some recognition among water resource engineers that systems are often underdesigned, but especially in older cities or just pretty much any cities in the Northeast and Midwest, you have infrastructure that was designed maybe 50 years ago or 100 years ago using rainfall events at the time. Even up basically until now, we're often using historical rainfall to sort of predict what future rainfall might be. So oftentimes these systems are underdesigned for what rainfall might be now, but especially 50 years in the future or longer.
The numbers we have describe how rainfall intensity has increased in the past. So is this a trend we should expect to continue to see into the future? And do we know what we're facing?
Yeah, you know, this is one of these things. There's certain aspects of climate change. We're very certain that temperatures will change. When we talk about how overall precipitation patterns might change, say sort of annual rainfall amounts, that's something we have less certainty about. But when we talk about rainfall intensity, because it's so closely tied to temperature, we have pretty high certainty with that. So right now we're anticipating, well, we're not anticipating, it depends on amount of greenhouse gases emitted by humans on Earth. But if we kind of stay on the track we're on now, we anticipate about a 3 degrees Celsius increase in temperature by 2100. So that would be somewhere around a 20 to 25% increase in rainfall intensity. And that's pretty reliable science in terms of that estimate.
What can individuals and communities do to adapt to these increased rainfall and flooding events?
Well, besides continue to think about, how to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, the other thing is just to sort of be aware of potential like green infrastructure projects. As infrastructure is modified and updated, right? Most communities probably every 25 to 30 to 40 years are changing infrastructure in the community, is to think about, can critical infrastructure be resized at that time? So one thing I always sort of say to people is, it seems like if every pipe in, under every roadway had to be changed, that maybe seems like too much, and most communities can afford that. But I think an important thing is decide like where are your critical areas. So if you have an intersection or a bridge that goes to your local hospital, maybe that's the place you prioritize. If you have roadways that already flood, we talk about sort of no regret approaches. If you already have existing flooding, fix that, and that'll put you in good shape for the future.
Professor Stephen Shaw of the State University of New York's College of Environmental Science and Forestry, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe. Check out our channel for more videos, and if you'd like to support our work, consider making a donation at greatlakesnow.org. See you out on the lakes.